Right. Good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year to you. And isn't it great to be able to join together and to start the new year by thinking of God's grace, which whether we realize it or not, and maybe we realize it more this year than any other, we are here only by God's grace, and we thank him for that. We're also very thankful that we are still able to gather legally this morning. The government as yet have not made any announcements about closing churches, and we hope that that will continue. Although, of course, we do have some concern there because, as you know, the statistics are all going in the wrong direction, and Boris even this morning is hinting at tighter restrictions. One thing that makes our case for staying open all the more robust is the fact that certainly here, and I haven't heard otherwise, there have been no cases of infection through church gatherings. And that's something that we want to continue. Even when we had our preacher last year had COVID, but didn't realise, and nobody caught it from him. And we're all very grateful and thankful for that, which means it's very important to do the old mask or glasses thing. If you notice, I swapped. It's either mask or glasses. You know the symptom if you wear glasses. So very important that we wear our masks. Very important that that we don't shout, and that we're very quiet in our speech. When we're inside, very important that we keep the windows open for some ventilation. So sorry about that if you're getting a little draft. We can't really avoid that. But at least the heating is on, and we'll try and sort of balance that out somehow. And also very important that we keep our conversations as far as possible outside. There's plenty of space outside. There's a whole world out there. It's not just the little bit of pavement that's on the front. We can go to the side there. We've got our garden there. And, of course, into the car park at the school that we can use as well for conversations. And you all know what the law is about socialising. So please be respectful of that. But as mentioned, we are really grateful that we are able to gather in person. We're also grateful that so many people are able to join online. I'm assuming there's people there, so I'm waving at them. Have we got a list of people there? Do you know who's joined us? Right, so they're the ones that have said hello, so hello to them, and hello to anyone else who's secretly watching. So I do know some people secretly watch, but it's great to have you joining. Great that we've got that technology. So, a few other notices. So we've got just a couple of activities this week. There's our prayer meeting on Zoom at 7:30 tomorrow, so do join us for that. And then it's a Bible study at 2 o'clock on Zoom on Tuesday. We haven't yet sorted out what's going to happen on the Thursday activities this year. You can obviously pray for that, either individually or at our gatherings, so that we've got wisdom to see how we can carry on our fellowship in the weeks and months ahead. So do pray for that. After this service online, there will also be a Zoom group catch-up, which Peter Titterton is hosting. So hopefully Peter is there somewhere. That will start immediately after the service, and there'll be a link posted up after the service for that as well. And I guess if you've got your mobile, you could even sort of, if you're here, you could even join in that as well. How about that? Great technology. Okay, so let's just commit this time now to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we do indeed thank you for your tremendous grace, and we thank you that we have grace this morning to gather or to join online and to worship you together. We pray that your hand would be on this whole service and indeed this whole year for your glory. Amen. So, over to the band.
Stand together, rejoice.
Stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence you'll hear. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands. Yeah. has walked this path before us. He is walking with us in, turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice when you cry. Lost at the fall, running away when I hear you call, thought you worked your will. I had the righteousness of my own, I had the right to draw near your throne. Father, you loved me still, and in love before you laid the world's foundation, you have chosen to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace.
Race by Happy New Year to all of you. Shall we now come before a holy God in prayer? Loving Father, we thank you that we can call you Father. We thank you that you are our spiritual Father, that we have been adopted into the family of God and are brothers and sisters in Christ our Lord. Lord, last year was a year like none of us had experienced before. Everybody's world was shaken, and many of the things that people relied on thought were unshakable proved to be anything but. And we would pray for all those who have lost loved ones, or their jobs, or careers, or their long-term health. We pray for those who are lonely, or have mental health problems, or have had difficulty homeschooling children. While we bring these things before you, we would also thank you that you are the unshakable God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We thank you that you can be the rock we can cling to in times of trouble. We thank you that whatever happens to us on earth, our salvation, our eternal life with you is assured. Our salvation, our eternal life with you is assured, as long as we have given our lives to the Lord Jesus. On this, the first Sunday of the new year, we would pray for the coming year. We pray that the vaccines will work and that COVID-19 will be defeated. And as our world returns to a new normal, that we will not forget that which is truly unshakable. We pray for our country as we enter into a new relationship with the EU. We ask that the trade deal negotiated between us will prove to be a fair one for both sides. For this chapel, we would ask that you use us mightily in your work in this coming year. Help us to rely only on God, our rock, not on the leadership, the chapel buildings, or any others who attend here. May we grow ever closer to and in likeness to our Lord Jesus. And may many come to know him because of his work done through us. Amen.
Good morning, family at chapel. Happy New Year. This week's reading is the last verse in John chapter 11 and the first eight verses of John chapter 12. It begins, "But the chief priests and Pharisees had given orders that if anyone found out where Jesus was, he should report it, so they might arrest him." Chapter 12. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus arrived at Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honour. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it onto Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, a keeper of the money bag. He used to help himself to what was put into it. "Leave her alone," Jesus replied. "It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Yeah, good morning. It is great to see so many lovely faces. Yeah, it's just great to be able to gather together as the people of God to worship together and to be all under one roof. So thank you. From me, thank you for making priority. Come on out at the beginning of the new year to make worship a priority. So really appreciate that. And I speak on behalf of all our church leadership. In some ways, it's harder than normal at the moment to just to be here. So thank you. Okay, just a little. One favor you can do me, besides being here already. I have an invitation to really soon to speak at a Pentecostal church. Now, I don't know if you know anything about Pentecostal churches, but they tend to be a little bit excitable, you know. But it's been a while since I've spoken at a Pentecostal church. So today you can help me out just a little bit by seeming a little bit interested and excited in what I'm saying. Okay, yeah, you know, if you have one of these, you can kind of wave it and, you know, be like, all right, amen. So that'll just help prepare me that if, you know, COVID restrictions and legal things all working out, that I'll be able to take this invitation. Otherwise, I might get up there, say a few words, everyone shouts amen, and then I freeze and don't know what to do with myself. So you can help adjust me. Yeah, thank you. All right. You got to wait for a punchline is the thing. You can't just randomly say it when I'm in mid-sentence. You got to be, like, it has to be, the way Pentecostal preachers do is they kind of pause, they like, have a sentence, and they think they've said something really profound, and they pause, and then, it's liturgical, in a sense. There's a certain liturgy about it, and it's beautiful when it works. It's just awkward when you're trying to imitate it, and you're no good. So, we'll see. All right. I'm just going to pray. It's a short story. It's not just a few verses. It's not long. It's a short story. But man, is it just, it's a fireball of a story. It really is. So I'm going to pray and in good Pentecostal fashion, pray that the Holy Ghost would fill me and fill this place. And he'll speak to us through his word. Father, we thank you for this just powerful little story. It's a nugget of a story, but wow, is it a golden nugget. And I pray that your Holy Ghost would be in this place to just unpack it and let the power and the explosiveness of the truth and the beauty of Christ be seen in your word. Amen. Amen. There you go. All right. You're off to a good start there. Yeah, there we go. That's it. All right. The setting of this story is an intense one. I mean, if there was ever a movie made or a TV show, or it would be a fantastic thriller. It would be something set almost like feeling under the Soviet Union or in Nazi Germany. It begins by saying that the chief priests and the Pharisees, they've just upped the game. You see, up till now, there's been this tension between the political and the religious leaders and Jesus and then his 12 apostles. But now, all of a sudden, at the end of chapter 11, after Lazarus has been raised from the dead, they're feeling the pressure. And so what they do in response is to make laws saying it is illegal to associate with Jesus. It is illegal to hang out with Jesus. It is illegal to have Jesus in your home. If you see Jesus, if you're near Jesus, if you find him, you must report him to the authorities. And all of a sudden, everybody else, the public, is involved with the passing of these laws. The chief priests, they would have been what we would have seen as sort of the legal side of things. And the Pharisees, they didn't have so much legal power as such because they were not authorized by the Romans, but they had incredible social power. When they spoke, people listened. In the law courts, in terms of the actual law, it was the chief priests, it was the Sadducees that had a lot of influence. They had deals with Rome, and so they had Roman backing. The Pharisees did not have Roman backing, but they were very popular with the people. They were the ones with the huge Twitter accounts, Facebook followings. Like, they were the rock star influencers. And very often, as you can imagine, sometimes the Pharisees and the chief priests and the Sadducees, they'd kind of bump heads. They had different agendas. And so sometimes there's this tension between the social leaders and the political legal leaders. But on this, they are both unified. They're both anti-Jesus. And these laws are passed, and they're saying, that's right, here's what we're going to do. They see Jesus' power as being the fact that he's so popular with common people. He does miracles. He preaches in a way that nobody else preaches. And they're like, right, if we want to take away Jesus' influence, we've got to take away his crowds. And the way we can take away the crowds is to make it illegal to be in Jesus' company. make it illegal to be a follower of his. If you see him, report him, and we'll arrest him. And so, no, it's no longer just between the Pharisees and Jesus. All of a sudden, everyone else is sucked into the middle. The public is sucked into the middle. And the question is, if you have been something of a Jesus fanboy up till now, like you'd like going to the big meetings, you maybe saw a miracle, you're hoping to get his autograph. If that was you, all of a sudden, you got a choice to make. All of a sudden, showing up to a Jesus meeting costs you something. It wasn't that way before. But dynamics have been set in motion where you can't stay neutral anymore. And that's how it is with Jesus. We can at least seem to be neutral for a while. We can take a sort of air of objectivity in approaching Jesus and thinking about Jesus. And yeah, he was all right, maybe. And say, yeah, there's a good and bad. And a lot of people, when it comes to Jesus, they try to have a neutrality, an objectivity. They watch, they like it, it's okay, but if it has to cost me something, all of a sudden that middle gets cleared out. In the long run, when it comes to Jesus, there is no neutrality. There is no completely neutral objectivity. You're going to go one direction or you're going to go the other. And this is what the laws of the Pharisees have done. This is what the law of the chief priests have done. All of a sudden, it becomes illegal to be a follower of Jesus. So what happens? Well, it's coming up to the Passover. Now, because most of you in here have been in church before and you know a little bit about the Jesus story, you know what's about to happen. It says 6 days before Passover. Now, if you've been in church anyway, you know what's going to happen. Jesus is going to his death. In a week's time, Jesus will be murdered and he will be dead. He will be buried. That's where this story is going. You know that. But the people in the story, remember, they did not know that. All they know is that Jesus is this super cool, popular rabbi. The crowds are following him. They love him. But at the same time, the authorities, the government, have just passed laws about being in his company. So what are we going to do? What is a good person supposed to do? It's very easy for us to think when we read the Bible. We kind of read these stories and we get these sort of two-dimensional views of the Pharisees or the bad guys. You know, you kind of watch a movie sometimes, it's a Bible story, maybe even a Marvel movie or some action adventure, and you kind of watch it and the bad guys are really two-dimensional bad. You know, they're just pure evil. They're just bad guys. And you think, man, if I was in that movie, I'd be one of the good guys. Or at least I'd support one of the good guys. I'd be a friend of the good guys, at least. And it's easy to do with that with the Bible. We kind of read these stories and think, you know what, man, if I lived back then, I would have been supporting Jesus 100%. There's no way I would have sided with the Pharisees, man. I would have known Jesus was the Son of God. Remember, this is before the resurrection. Jesus has not died on the cross. He has not risen from the dead. A lot of people think he's the Messiah, but there's very blurred understanding of what it means to be the Messiah. It kind of has some of these political implications, but still people aren't sure. They know Jesus is kind of breaking the paradigms of what it means to be the Messiah. So he has this messianic aura, but that's for many that's a bit ill-defined. And all of a sudden, they have a real choice to make. And do not fall into the temptation of automatically thinking that if you were in this situation, you would automatically be one of the good guys. That you would automatically have sided with Jesus. It's not, don't take that for granted. We do that in history class. I like history. One of my children here, Ransom, he also is a big history guy. And it's easy to... One of the mistakes I make when I read history books is, especially like World War II stuff. How many of you like you love a good World War II movie? World War II. It's so easy when you read that stuff to think, man, if I had lived back then, I would have been hiding all sorts of Jews under my basement. I would have been helping them escape. No way I would have compromised with the Nazis. I wouldn't have submitted to any of their laws. Uh-uh. Let me just tell you, statistically, that's wrong. Statistically, we would have been compliant, and even if we didn't like the laws, we would have submitted to them. Statistically, the chances of any of us being among those who hid Jews and helped them escape, it would have been incredibly small, regardless of how good you think you are. Because when the political pressure's on, when the legal pressure's on, when the social pressure's on, all of a sudden, you imagine all these great moral justifications of why what we say, well, I don't necessarily like what the Nazi government's doing, but I'm going to go along with it. We think ourselves the good guys. Statistically, it wouldn't be the case. This time when the pressure's on, and it says something happens then at Bethany. This is the context for our story. Legal, political, social pressures against not only Jesus and his disciples, but people having anything to do with them. It says, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was the one Jesus had raised from the dead. So what did they do? They have a choice. Jesus rocks up in the village again with his 12 disciples. He has friends there. He's popular there. He did a couple of big miracles there. Matthew gives us an alternative view of this account. Matthew talks about Simon the leper, or Simon the ex-leper. Simon, the guy who used to be a leper, as being among these friends of Jesus. So he's popular. He had a lot of friends. When Jesus rocks up to the village, how does the village respond giving the new sets of laws from the Jerusalem government? They have a choice to make, don't they? They're good citizens. They're used to listening to the Pharisees. They're used to submitting to the chief priests and the backings in Rome. They're used to doing all these things. But now Jesus is in town. So what are they supposed to do? What's a good person supposed to do in this situation? Don't automatically think that this would have been an easy choice. It would have been a choice that would have split families. It would have separated friends. They would have argued with each other over what the right thing to do was. Do not automatically think that you and your friends and your family, if you were back then, it would have been a clear choice and you obviously would have sided with Jesus. Don't think that. When you're actually in the event, it feels a lot more complicated. Someone pointed out to me this year for the first time, we can actually say hindsight is 20/20. And it's true, hindsight is 20/20 always, particularly this year, but all throughout history. We can look back at these stories and be like, yeah, those guys made the wrong call. But if we had been in there in the moment, what would we have done it? What would we have done? So they rock up, and what does these people do? It says, they gave a dinner for him there. Given the context of the story, do you think that was an easy thing to do? They gave a dinner for him there. Oh, I'm just going to have Jesus and his 12 disciples over. No biggie. Only that's illegal. As Jesus, and it's actually at Simon the leper's house. There's a number of people, at least according to Matthew. Lazarus is involved. We're going to see some of Jesus' friends. They get together, and they're going to have Jesus and his 12 disciples over Lazarus' house. It's presumably a nice big house. A lot of people there. What did the neighbors think? I don't know. What did the villagers think? I don't know. Was anyone tempted to report to the authorities that Jesus and his disciples were over Simon's house with Lazarus and Mary and Martha? Were some people saying, all right, should we turn these guys in? Or maybe we should just be silent. Maybe we should just be neutral and not do nothing. We know our neighbors are breaking the law. Are we going to report them? I don't know. But it's funny. It's crazy. It's a crazy situation to be in. They made a dinner for him there. That took courage. It took courage and it took a lot of moral clarity. John gets very specific. Martha was serving them. Now normally, that's sweet. The idea of Martha serving Jesus and her 12 disciples, that's sweet. Only she's breaking the law while she's doing it. Lazarus was one of those reclining at the table with him. Lazarus is getting quality time with his friend Jesus, fellowshipping with Jesus, hanging out with his 12 disciples. Only that's illegal. Everything about this is people deciding to meet with Jesus, to be with Jesus, to listen to what he has to say, his teachings, to fellowship with him, to fellowship with his disciples, to use their gifts to serve him, but in a context that's very hostile, socially hostile, legally hostile. And then it gets to the climax of the story. Then Mary. Mary took a pound of fragrant oil, pure and expensive nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped his feet with her hair. So the house was filled with the fragrance of oil. Now, if I was really Pentecostal now, I'd really pull out the whole thing about the oil and the anointing and all of this, but I'm not quite good enough yet to do that. But this is a... It's hard for me to emphasize how scandalous this whole thing is. Okay, just for example. All right. How awkward would it be if I'm up here preaching and then some woman came up and all of a sudden started weeping at my feet, lets her hair down, and all of a sudden starts rubbing my feet and kissing them in front of you all? Like, that would be really awkward. My wife here would think that's really awkward. I don't know. I might think it's great. I don't know. I might think it's super. But my wife probably wouldn't like it. My kids would really think it's awkward. I'm sure one of the young people would take out their phone and take shots and it would be all over Instagram and social media by the end of the day. Like, that would be awkward. But remember, this is a time and a generation and a nation and a place where there was much more distancing between men and women. Like, men and women were supposed to be socially apart in many ways. After church, so, you know, because of our laws, we fellowship outside instead of inside. But after church, you'll see people talking, and you'll see men talking with women and women talking with men. That didn't happen so much back then. It didn't happen. Now, Jesus was known to have a reputation where he took time to teach women. He was a rabbi who taught women, and most rabbis did not do that. But he taught women, and he befriended women, and, you know, he had Martha and Mary. So he already has a reputation of being very opening to the company of women. But this is a bit different. Like, this is really taking it to the whole next level here. Like, she comes, it says she lets her hair down. Like, that's a bit, woo. Like, you can just imagine socially, like, even in our day. Like, okay, even in the Western, sexualized, 20th, 21st century, okay, you're watching a Netflix film. And a man and a woman are in company together. Maybe it's the evening, they're talking, some conversation. And then all of a sudden she lets down her hair and shakes the hair, and the hair goes everywhere. What does that mean? What do we know is about to happen? Like, they're going to be making out real soon and probably doing more than make. Like, it's just, it's a bit of a sign when her hair comes down, she shakes it, and it's like, whoa, okay. You feel kind of the tension going up in the room a little bit. Like, back then, this was scandalous. So far, everything about this party is wrong. Socially, politically, by the values of the day. I mean, Jesus is blowing his witness here. It's like, Jesus, you have a reputation to maintain. Come on, Jesus, people think you're at least an ethical, moral rabbi. What are you doing letting this woman all over your feet? Like, come on, get with it, Jesus. Now, we know that Jesus is the Son of God. We've read John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word. We know Jesus isn't your average man in the same sense that a normal man would be. He is God incarnate. So there's a difference. And yes, not that I think any of you are, but please don't anyone ever come up and kiss my feet, because that would be very awkward. And I'm 100% sure none of you are even contemplating that. But with Jesus, it was different because of who he was. But most people didn't fully appreciate that. Again, this is pre-resurrection stuff. They see him as the Messiah, but do they fully know that this is God come among us? Maybe some of them were wondering, but it wasn't as clear as it is to us. So she comes and she anoints it, and it says she broke. So already it's everything is wrong. Everything about this party is wrong. And if the police, like the police are on their way to shut these people down. I mean, it's socially inappropriate. It's illegal. Like the whole, there's a long list of why this party should be shut down. But then there's one more thing. This whole thing, this fragrant oil. Back then, perfume, it's not what it is today. Ladies, if you want a nice bottle of perfume, fellas, if you want a little bit of cologne, by the way, fellas, there's a few of you who could probably profit to buying some cologne, by the way. You want a little bit of perfume, ladies, you can go to this, you can go to Tesco, and you can buy an okay bottle for, I don't know, what, 15 pounds or something? Maybe less, maybe more. I don't buy a lot. Okay? But you can buy just a reasonable bottle and make yourself smell a little better. Back then, they didn't have the synthetic ways of making it. Back then, if you were going to get this bottle of what they call pure nard, it's like this very thick, saturated, fragrant oil. Man, that was like a family heirloom. You're talking thousands of pounds right here. And these things were saved. They were given like as wedding gifts. Very expensive gift. This family, Lazarus, I already hinted at this last time we talked, but they're not a poor family. They're at least middle class. Sometimes we get the idea that Jesus was just this poor, broke guy and all his followers were just poor, broke people. Well, there was a lot of poor people who loved Jesus and followed Jesus, but some of his disciples and closest friends were more what we would call middle class. They had houses that they could have Jesus over for parties. They were fishermen who owned their own businesses and had servants help them. And here, one of his friends, she has a very expensive heirloom worth, in today's money, at least 10,000 pounds. Maybe more. She comes and she breaks it and she pours the entire container on Jesus' feet. That's a lot of money. That's expensive. She pours up it and the fragrance fills the whole house. Everyone notices this. Like the woman, the hair, the tears, the perfume. It's like already this party was tense. Already, you could kind of cut the, you know, there's the political, and all of a sudden now, Mary just takes this thing to the whole new level. Like, no one will ever forget this party for the rest of their lives. This is the most whack party you can imagine. No one knows to say, you know, if this happened, we were at a party like this, we'd just be like, huh, I don't know what to think about this right now. We'd be scratching our heads. Well, finally, somebody speaks up and says something. That good, moral, righteous, ethical man, Judas Iscariot. Man, he would be popular nowadays. What does he say? Why wasn't this fragrant oil sold for 300 denarii? Again, that in today's money, that'd be at least 10,000 pounds. And given to the poor. He didn't say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief and in charge of the money bag and would seal part of what was put in. So he's the treasurer. He was the church treasurer, but he was skimming off the top. Jesus and his disciples, they had a lot of money flowing through their ministry, and a lot of it did go to the poor, and a lot of it went to help people. But the treasurer, he was pocketing just a little bit of commission right there. And so the idea of, you know, wow, if that gift had passed through, even if he only was keeping back 1% or 2%, it would have been kind of nice, a little bit of pocket change for him. And so he's always wanting more money to pass through the church, more money to pass through the ministry. It's good, yeah, it's going to help the poor people, of course, but, you know, I'm the treasurer, so I get my commission. But think about the ethic. How do you think Mary felt when she heard that? Remember, there's this woman, Mary. She just did an incredible thing. She took the most expensive item she had. She got down and she broke it open and she poured out the contents, this thick perfume, this thick oil that was incredibly fragrant, made through natural processes. Maybe the most expensive heirloom she had, she breaks it, pours on Jesus' feet, uses her hair, kisses it. I mean, it's incredible. Act of affection and devotion she's showing him. Maybe she felt vulnerable afterwards. Like, did I just do the wrong thing? No one's ever done this before. What was I thinking? And then what happens? One of Jesus' disciples shames her. Tisk, 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 tisk. What have you just done? Don't you know that that money, that all that money you just wasted on Jesus' feet, that should have been sold in. Think about all those poor people out there, Mary. Come on, Mary, where's your priorities? Where's your values? Don't you care about all these poor people you have out there on your doorstep? And she's shamed. She's shamed and scorned because of her devotion to Jesus. I got to tell you, there's a lot of people nowadays that would have think what Judas said made perfect sense. Why do something so wasteful, like pour that perfume on Jesus' feet? Sell it. Give it to the poor. Doesn't that sound moral? Doesn't that sound ethical? Doesn't that sound like the right thing to do? It does. Jesus, when he hears about it, he says, leave her alone. The people scolding Mary for her devotion for Jesus get scolded by Jesus in the end. Leave her alone. She has kept it for the day of my burial, for you always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me. Everything that's against Jesus at this time, the political, social, it all has a moral edge to it. No one's going around saying, we're trying to shut down Jesus because we don't like Jesus. No one's going around saying, we're trying to shut him down because we're jealous. You remember, we talked about this in the last chapter, before Christmas. What was the reasoning behind why the chief priests and the Pharisees, what was the reasoning behind them passing these laws? How were they thinking? Were they thinking, ha ha, we're bad people, we're the supervillains, and we're out to get the good guy, wah ha ha ha. Is that what they were doing? No. They were saying, their reasoning for these laws was, listen, Jesus is becoming so popular, and he's infusing so many people with messianic fervor that we need to do what's right for the Jewish community, and we need to shut this thing down. Otherwise, the Romans are going to come in, and a lot of people are going to get killed, and we can't have that happen. And so we're going to do the right thing. We're going to do the noble thing. We're going to protect our people. And if Jesus has to be deplatformed, if Jesus has to be canceled, if Jesus has to be killed, so be it. It's better that one person die for the sake of the community, for the sake of the collective, for the sake of everybody. It's best to get Jesus out of the way. That way we can keep people safe from the Romans. Their thinking and their moralizing and their rationalizing what they're doing is good. All the opposition to the people of God, not only here in John, but then as you go throughout Acts and read about the persecution of local churches, there's always an excellent moral, ethical sounding reason behind it to shut down the early church. But behind all of it, behind all the rationale, behind all the faux ethics, behind all the nice sounding, we need to do what's good for all the people in Israel, so Jesus will just have to be a sacrifice we're willing to make. Behind all of that is a lack of understanding on who Jesus is. The person of Jesus. Mary gets it. I mean, Lazarus gets it. Lazarus is having fellowship with Jesus and his disciples. Martha gets it. She's using her gifts to serve Jesus. But Mary, wow, she especially gets it. This isn't just anybody. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was made, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. This is it. You woke up this morning. You were alive this morning. You had breath in your lungs. That's because of Jesus. Is your heart beating right now? Are you alive? It's because Jesus is sustaining you. God didn't kill you in your sleep last night, even though you sinned yesterday. It's because Jesus was there showing you mercy and showing you love and not condemnation. This is the one who sustains and holds the universe together. I wouldn't be alive if it weren't for him. I owe him my worship, my allegiance, my all. And if worshiping him gets me in trouble with the Pharisees, so be it. And if I break the law of the chief priests to anoint his feet and to worship him, I'll break it. And if I get scorned by the moralizers like Judas, who says things like, come on, it should have been sold, given to the poor. Think about the community. Be a good humanitarian. If I get scorned, if I get shamed, if I get imprisoned, if I get fined, any of these things, I'm going to do it because Jesus is my life. He is my everything. He's my creator, my sustainer. She gets it. Judas doesn't. Ah, church, this is good stuff. You can say amen here. How do we get this? Because naturally, I'm not like Lazarus. Naturally, I'm not like Martha. Naturally, I'm not like Mary. I want to keep my nose clean. I want to get on life without a lot of trouble. I have a nice business. I have a nice job. I don't want to get in trouble with the authorities and the influencers. And I don't want to be shamed. I don't want to be scorned. I don't like those things. Probably you don't either. Maybe there's one or two anarchists somewhere in here by personality. Maybe that's you, but 90% of us aren't that way. 90% of us aren't geared like Lazarus, Martha, and Mary. We're not. When we get political, social opposition, we're not serving like Martha. When we get the opposition, we're not hanging out with Jesus and his disciples like Lazarus. When we get the opposition, we're certainly not worshiping as wholeheartedly as Mary is. We don't. We back off. What did they know? What did they have that we so easily lack? Jesus hints at it. He hints at it right there at the end. Leave her alone. She's kept it for my burial, for you do not always have the poor with you. Somehow Mary knows what's about to happen with Jesus. Now, don't ask me how Mary knows. I don't know. Maybe it's something he told her in private conversation. I mean, they were friends after all, so maybe she knew, or maybe she just got the revelation through the Holy Ghost. I don't know how she got it, but she knew. Somehow that information was downloaded to her. She knew Jesus was about to leave. She knew that he was about to die. She did it for his burial, he says. And listen, this is it. There's only one place to get strength to live a life like Mary or Lazarus or Martha, to be among those friends, to be among those who follow Christ even in the face of incredible social, moral, ethical sounding opposition. And that's to know that Jesus, before we ever show that sort of devotion to Jesus, he has shown that to us. She broke that little, container and poured out the perfume all over Jesus' feet. But that was nothing compared to what Jesus was about to do. Jesus wasn't about to break out some container and pour out perfume. His body was about to be broken and his blood poured out for you and for me and for Mary and for Martha and Lazarus. The most expensive thing, precious thing, is not the perfume. The most precious thing in this book is the blood of Jesus that's about to be shed. And somehow Mary had a picture of what was about to happen. She knew what was about to happen. She knew the costliness of what was about to be broken and poured out for her sake. So the least she could do was break open this heirloom, because it was nothing as compared to the value of Jesus. You'll never be able to worship Mary, Jesus like Mary. You'll never begin to worship Jesus like Mary does. unless you understand the value of what Christ has given you. If you know what Jesus, he went through all sorts of opposition to love you. He went through political opposition to love you. He went through social opposition to love you. He was scorned. He was mocked. The ethicists of the day, the moralizer of the day, the tisk, tisk, tisk people, the shamers of the day, they were all against Jesus, and he took it all on himself because he loves you, because he wants to forgive you, because he wants to be in relationship with you, because he wants to take your sinful heart and forgive you, because he wants to make you a child of God. Jesus paid a price that we can't even begin to fathom. So when we think we're doing good because, you know, we come out to church in the morning, or because we take time to read the Bible, or we take time to pray. You know what? Wonderful. That's great. But man, that's a little baby step compared to what he has done for us. It's great when we show our little bit of love to God. He's our Father. He thinks it's cute. He'll take it. Absolutely. And he'll take it joyfully. But don't think we're impressing God somehow. Don't think he's like, whoa. Yeah, wow. It's like, no. He's the one who's impressed by pouring out his very life, his very blood for us. And so if we get scorned, if we get mocked, if we get fined, if we get opposition from friends, from the neighbors, from the government, all in our devotion to follow and worship Christ, it is a small thing, church. It's not that we're not that impressive. He's the impressive one. His love for you is the impressive one. And if you get that in your heart, you're going to live differently because of it. You're going to begin to look a little bit like Lazarus and Martha and Mary. Not just because you're trying to imitate them, but because you know what they know. It's not like we say, oh, I need to be a good person like Lazarus and Martha. And no, you know what they know, and you'll do it automatically, and you'll do it happily. You'll do it joyfully, because it's the most wonderful thing. Here we go. I have a kind of a special relationship with our church worship leader. So I can ask her to do things on the fly and know I'll get in trouble for it in the afternoon, I'm sure. But can I have the church worship leader come up here for just a second? And we're just going to sing a cappella, Come Let Us Adore Him. Okay? We know this song. It's just been Christmas time. So really didn't plan on ending with a song, but I think in talking about worship like this, we need to express our adoration to him. So can I just ask everyone to stand for a second? I'm going to key in. Just lead us in the chorus. Just we'll go through the chorus a couple times. Come, let us adore him. And then I'll hand it back over to Andrew.
Okay.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord.
For he alone is worthy.
For he alone is worthy.
Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your life was broken and spilled out for us. Lord, may we be a people who respond to that and begin to pour out our lives for you. Even the face of the Judases and the Pharisees and the chief priests of this world, Lord, may our devotion be poured out to you as yours was to us. Amen. All right, AP.
Oh. So, amen. Amen indeed. So in a moment, we're just going to close with the words of the grace. Before that, just to remind those that are online, that there'll be a link put up in a moment for you to click to go into the Zoom meeting so that you can have fellowship online. And for those who are here physically, remember to move outside promptly and to respect all the laws about social distancing and everything else when you're having conversations outside. But let's just end this service by reflecting back on that grace that we began the service with. Now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the
love of God
and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.